Hello everyone. So today I am Gurveen Kaur, Assistant Professor in Department of Management Studies. I'm going to discuss the topic discharge and performance of contract. So basically performance of contract and discharge of performance of contract, it depicts that who will actually perform that contract. So there are basically the two parties. The one is the promisor and the another is the promisee. So both of them, there are the two parties. So who is going to perform, who is going to actually perform, who is going to make an attempt to perform, would all those things would come into the performance of contract. So whenever any offer is being performed, that is known as the tender of performance. So whether the performance is being actually performed or it is being attempted to perform, these things come into the discharge of contract by performance. So basically performance means that whether the contract, it has been finalized, it has been performed, it actually happened or not. So that is into the performance. So performance may be actual performance one type and the another may be attempted performance. So actual performance, when both the parties perform their respective promises, a contract is said to have been actually performed. So when both have perform their duties and both have actually done with their promise part. So that is known as the actual performance. Attempted performance, offer to perform may be called as attempted performance. So when we are giving some offer that let's do like this, let's have a coffee, let's make an notes, let's make an academy, let's have a class kind of thing. So when we are offering something to perform, that would come into the attempted performance. That is not actually, it is just an offer which is given to someone. Offer to perform is called a tender of performance. Now, what are the essentials of a valid tender? Tender must be unconditional. There must not be any conditions into this. Tender must be made at a proper time and proper place. It must be defined that when this offer is going to happen, when this performance is going to happen. So at what time, on what day, on what place. So all those, at what place, all those things are need to be mentioned over here. Tender must be made under such circumstances that the person to whom it is made may have a reasonable opportunity of ascertaining that the person by whom it is made is able and willing to fulfill the whole of its promises. So the tender must be made in such a form that a person to whom it is being made, a offer which is made to someone or a promise which is made to someone, he must have a reasonable opportunity for ascertaining that the person by whom it is made. So by whom it is made, they are willfully and they want to perform it. And the whole of the promise is being willfully performed over there. Means the another party is also agreeing to perform all these essentials, all these tenders, all these promises over there. So there must be a proper correlation between the two things. So that would deal with the tender of performance. Next, fourth, if an offer is an offer to deliver anything, the promisee must have a reasonable opportunity of seeing that thing offered is the thing which is promised is bound to be delivered. So whatever is being promised, suppose I promise that I will deliver you 100 bags which are red in color. Now the person want to see that whether it is red in color or not. So whatever is being promised, whatever product is being promised, the same is to be delivered. It doesn't mean that the delivery will be of the yellow bags, but promise was done for the red bags. No. It must be the same thing which was being promised. The tender must be whole and not only in the parts. So whatever promise is being done, it should be completed in one part only. It should be completed in one go only. It must not be divided into the different parts. Tender must be made to the promisee or his duly authorized agent. So it must be made to the promisee. Suppose A and B are the two parties. A is giving a promise and the B is the promisee. So B will accept that promisee, either B will do it or B has assigned someone as an authorized agent on the place of B. In the absence of B, that person will be liable to make every promises and will be taking decisions for B if he is absent, if B is absent. So a promisee can make the promises or the promisee can attempt to all those things on his own or by his duly authorized agent to him, what to him, to the person to whom he has been authorized. Tender made to one of the several promises has the same effect as the tender to all of. So if it is made to one promisor, then also it will remain the same. This promise will remain the same. And if it is made to the many others, then also it will remain the same. So the things would go in the same way. If any promisee neglects or refuses to offer the promise reasonable facilities for the performance of the promisee. So whatever facilities which were being decided or which were being fixed at the starting of the promise, they must be given all together when the promise is being performed. So whatever facilities, whatever conditions which were being noted down, which were being observed and which were being promised to be conducted at the time of the starting of the promise, the same must happen at the end also. So no condition must remain unfulfilled. The tender must be in a proper form. So the tender must happen in a proper form. It should not be in such a way that documents are not there or something, it will be go in the verbal form only. No, it must be performed in a proper way. The party making a tender must be ready and willing to fulfill the obligations whenever called upon. So all the obligations, all the conditions which are remaining unfulfilled, they must be called upon and they must be completed up at the time of the tender. A mere offer by the post to pay the amount is not a valid tender. So whenever there is a post to pay the amount, whenever it is an offer to post to pay the amount, means it will be in the form of the post, then it will not remain as a valid tender. It must be done with the proper way and a proper condition. A tender may either be a tender of goods or the tender of money. So it will be related to the goods delivery or it may be payment of the money. So these all are the essential, these 12 are the essentials of the valid tender which are happening in the performance of the contract. Next is the person entitled to demand the performance. So first is the promisee. A third party cannot demand the performance. So the performance will be demanded by only the two persons, the promisor and the promisee. So any third person cannot enter into this contract or cannot enter into this promise kind of thing. Then the legal representative. Now the legal representative would come into the scene if in case of a death of the promisee, or he is a legal representative of the promisee and he has been demanded for the performance to happen. So he is legal representative, he is legally authorized to do the performance, then he or she would enter as a legal representative for the performance of that promise. Next is the joint promises. When a person has made a promise to two or the more persons. So A is one person who has made a promise to B and C. The same promise have been made to B and the same promise have been made to C. So that would come into the joint promisee. So when one person has made the same promise to two or more persons. Next is the third party. A third party can demand performance of the contract in the certain cases. First, now what are these certain cases? First, by the parties. As per the section 37 of the Act, promisor, as per the section 40 of the Act, representative, as per the section 37, the agent as per the section 40, and the third person as per the section 41 of the contract at 1872. So the third party would demand into these kind of contract in certain cases only, by the party, by the promisor, by the representative, by the agent, and by the third person. Now, what is the time to be performed? When it is to be performed? Where no time is specified. Now, there are three conditions. When there is no time specified, when the time is specified, or on application for the performance by the promisee. Now, when no time is specified, then it will be considered after some time, it will be considered to have been expired. When the time is specified, suppose I have specified 1 month, then it will be happening only in the 1 month, means till 30th September, it should happen. So it will happen till 30th September. After 30th September, it will not be considered as a valid promise, or it will not be considered as a valid contract on the application by the performance by the promisee. So if a person, the second person, the promisee feel that I want some time, so he can give a written application in which it will be mentioned that the time should be kept this much rather than this. It must be kept, suppose, 30th October rather than 30th September. So that must be mentioned on that application and it must be specified over there. Next is the performance of reciprocal promises. Performance. First is the mutual and the dependent. So the performance of the one party depend upon the prior performance of the other party. So how it will happen? If the first party has performed his liability, has performed his obligations, then only the second party will able to perform his own duties over there in the performance of the contract. And in the vice versa, if the first have not done, then how can the second can do it? So it will not happen. If the first person has not delivered the goods, then how the second person will make the payment? No. Once the goods are delivered, then only the payment will happen. Second, mutual and independent. So first was the mutual and dependent. The another one is the mutual and independent. Each party must perform independently. You make the payment on your part and we will deliver the goods on this day. So that is the independent one. Next is the mutual and concurrent. The promise has to be performed simultaneously. At the same time, the things must happen. So it must happen on the same time, under the same condition, and simultaneously both the things must be happening. Next, appropriation of the payment rules in the Clayton cases. So first, these rules were being described over this very famous case, that was the Clayton case. So first was the express appropriation by the debitor, implied appropriation by the debitor, principal and interest by both are due, appropriation by the creditor, appropriation by the law. The rules in Halton's estate. So first rule over here is, if the parties to the contract agree to substitute a new contract, then a new contract would come over there. So contract must be needed, not being performed. So if the parties ask for the contract, be substituted by the new contract, so that would be the first case. Then the promise must dispend with or remit wholly or partly the performance of the promise made by him. So the promises may dispend, may delete that the whole of the promise, or it may delete the part of the promise and then it can perform. When a person at whose option a contract is voidable, so it must be over there. It must be resigned at that time. So whenever the whole of the contract is not considered over there, when the options for the contract is not being resigned, then it would consider as the voidable. If any promisee neglects or refuses to offer the promise reasonable facilities, so when the reasonable facilities are not being offered, then again this contract would be considered as a contract which is not being it will be a void contract and it will not be performed over there. So that would be the performed with promise which would come into the neglect part. Next, it would consider when a contract becomes a void because the supervene impossibilities or illegalities. So the possibilities, the conditions which are there in the contract, they are not able to be fulfilled. They can't be fulfilled. They are impossible or they are legally wrong. So then also the contract would consider to be a void contract. When a person has a right to resign a contract, when a person, suppose I am a person, I have given a promise and I have a right that I can cancel this contract. So I can cancel that contract in that condition. When a promisor is excused by the another law, when some promisor is being excused by the court itself, when the court says that, okay, this promise cannot happen or this person cannot enter into such kind of contract. So again, that contract would be considered as a void contract. Next are the discharge of the contract by new agreement. When one contract is not at all fulfilled, but a new contract comes. So first condition would come over the novatia, novation or the substitution. Some new contract got substituted. A contract is not being fulfilled. So in place of A, B contract comes. So A has been substituted by B. So we are considering the new contract now. Some conditions have been changed in A and it has been relaunched. It has been reissued as B contract. So that is being substituted by the B contract. Alterations, change in terms of the contract. So the terms, the conditions which are over there, they have been changed. Recessions, if the parties agree to resign it. So when the party says that, okay, we need a change. We want to cancel this contract. Remission, acceptance of the lesser sum compared to the original contract. So the lesser sum has been compared with the original contract, means the earlier contract has been compared with the new contract has been compared with the original contract, which was over there, and the changes have been introduced over there, or some new conditions have been introduced over there. Then the waiver to dispense with. So we are going to cancel that contract. We are going to cancel few conditions out of that. Then merger, when the superior rights and the inferior, they are going to come together. When the superior rights and the inferior, they are come together, means the both the conditions, the superior and the inferior would come into the earlier contract and the new contract. They are being merged with the new conditions and a new has been lost over there. So that would come into the merger, means the two contracts, they have been merged together to launch a fresh contract out of it. Then the discharge of the contract by the operation of law. So earlier it was the new agreement, now it will be operation of law. So first would be insolvency. The promisor is discharged. So the promisor is discharged out of it. He is being freed out of it. Merger extinguishing the rights. So the rights have been waived off. Death, the death of the promisor discharge the contract. So the promisor is not there. He is no more in the world, then how the promise can happen. Lapse of time, the Limitation Act. As per the Limitation Act 1963, when the time has expired, the contract cannot happen. Then the material alteration or the unauthorized alteration. The change in one or the more of the material terms of the contract. So when the terms of the contract, they are not clear. When the terms of the contract, they have been altered. Or the terms of the contract has been changed without given notice. Then it will not be considered over here. Next, discharge of the contract by impossibilities. The things which are not at all possible. The things which cannot happen. So those are the impossibilities. Meaning, according to Section 56, impossibilities of the performance may fall into, first, impossibilities existing at the time of the contract, known as pre-contractual or initial impossibilities. So these impossibilities are under the Section 56. And they may fall into when at the time of the contract, the pre-contractual conditions, they are not being fulfilled, or the initial impossibilities are over there. Initially, in the very starting of the contract, we know that it is not a valid contract. It cannot happen. So at the very beginning of the contract, we are clear with the terms and the conditions that this is not possible. Suppose I want to make a restaurant in air. So it is not possible. How could I make it in air? Fine. So these are the impossibilities which are not at all. So in the very starting, it is not possible. So that is impossibilities which exist, which are at the time of the starting only, at the very initial stage. Then subsequent or supervening the impossibilities, also known as the post-contractual impossibilities. At the end, it won't happen. Post-contractual. After the contract has been covered or after the things have happened, the things won't be possible. The things won't happen. So that would come into the post-contractual impossibilities. Next are the cases which are covered under the supervening impossibilities. Now this would come into the destruction of the object necessary for the performance of the contract. So we are going to destruction. The destruction is going to happen for the objects which are necessary for the performance of the contract, the conditions which are necessary, the things which are necessary to be held for the performance of the contract. Now they are being destructed. They are being, you know, they are being dissolved. They are being destructed at the time of the things. The something changes are being happening over there. Then the change of the law. The law is being changed. Impersonal incapability. So personal incapacity would come over there. Means the person is not able to perform that thing. Outbreak of the war. So war is there. Natural calamities comes. So because of all those things, the contract is impossible to be completed. So these are the things, these are the conditions under which the contract cannot be completed. Cases not covered by the supervening impossibilities. First is the difficulty of performance. Performance can happen, contract will happen, but there are some problems, there are some difficulties. So that would not covered over there. Then commercial impossibilities. Commercially, something is over there. So commercially, the profit earning things are there. So these impossibilities cannot be considered. Impossibilities due to the behavior of the third party. So third party is not considered in a contract. Self-induced impossibilities. A person in himself thinks that, okay, this contract cannot happen. So that is his own thinking, his own supervision. He is making in himself. He is induced in himself that the thing cannot happen. So it is not at all agreed and it is not at all covered. Then the strike, lockouts, and the civil disturbance. So any civil disturbance means riots are there, lockdowns are there, strikes are there, some kind of, you know, we can say that the protest is there. Then under these conditions also the contract will be fulfilled, it will happen. Then partial impossibilities, half of the thing is impossible, no, this is not possible. Then the rights and the obligation under a transfer of the property under a case. So transfer of the property, it will happen. It can happen. No problem is there. Then temporary interruptions, matter with the contemplation of the parties. So temporary interruptions means for a time being, there is some problem. For the time being, there is, suppose holidays are coming. So that is for time being. Some, you know, break has been given. So that would be for time being. Suppose floods are there, or you may say there is a heavy rain going on. So these are the temporary matters which are being considered. A person is on leave. So the paperwork cannot be completed. The legal representative, the legal, bindings cannot happen because one person is on leave. So that is temporary phase. It will be over after some time. Then breach of contract and the remedies. When there is a breach of contract. So actual breach of the contract at the time when the performance is due. Anticipatory breach of contract by with the revocation of the contract. So that is the anticipatory contract. So these things would come into the breach of the contract. So next is the measure of the damages in anticipatory breach of contract. So first is if the contract is ended at once. So when the contract is going to end at once only, at the one in the same time, the amount of the damage will be measured by the difference between the prices prevailing on the date of the breach. So whatever prices which was being fixed on the date of the breach means on which he has not performed his contract or performed his promise, that would come into the date of the breach. So on the date when the promise was not performed, that will be the date of the breach. So on that day, what was the amount of the damage which was occurred, that will be measured and that will be paid back. If the contract is kept alive till the date of the performance of the contract. Here, the damage will be on the date of the performance. So it is kept alive till the performance of the contract. So whenever the person says, okay, I will perform the contract. And on one day, he suddenly says, okay, I am unable to perform the contract. On the day when he refuses to perform that contract, on that day, whatever rate is being fixed, whatever amount is of the damage, that will be paid on the same day. Now, what are the kind of damages, which are different kind of damages, which are considered over here in the breach of contract. First is the ordinary or the general damage. The damage parties are out to know. So they must know on which day, on the day of the performance, what was the normal damage which was happened. Suppose the paperwork was there, so money was paid for the same. Next is the special damage resulting out of the breach of the contract. Suppose I have made the material, but the another person says that, okay, I don't want the material, or and I am unable to make the payment for the material. So I have prepared the material, so the contract has not been fulfilled. So that person will be paying me back for that material because he was not able to perform. Then exemplary damage shows the court's disapproval. So the court will enter over here in the scene, and court will decide what the damage was. Nominal damage, contemporary damage. There's some damage which has happened over there in the specific part. So that would come into the normal part. Then liquidity damage. So first is the reasonable and the proportionate. The amount involved. So how much amount is involved? 100%. Or some reasonable amount, we will fix some reasonable amount, means we will do 50-50 kind of thing. Or we will say, okay, you pay this much only, we will manage it. Or proportion, fine, 40-60, 30-70, we will divide into the proportion. Then fair and genuine, the damage is fair and genuine. When the damage has actually happened and we know that it was an actual damage which has happened, so that will be paid for the same. Then object, to secure compensation. So whatever compensation is being paid, so that must be secured over there. So that must be objective, what it was being considered. Recovered through the court as permitted by the court. So that will be as per the permission of the court. Then court's power. The court has no power to liquidate the damage. So court won't be considered over there. Next are the principles of the restitution. So first, in case of the voidable contract, that will be under section 64, the contract become voidable. So in case of a voidable contract only, so that would come into the restitutions. In case of the contract becoming void, when an agreement is discovered to be void, when we discover that the agreement, there is nothing in agreement and it cannot change into the contract, so that would be a void contract. Suit for the specific performance. So who can sue and who will be sued for the same? Means who can enter into the court, where the monetary compensation is an adequate remedy. So when the compensation can be paid, that is okay. The remedy is there. So the person will pay the compensation. When the court cannot supervise the execution of the contract. So when the court cannot supervise the thing, that whether it has happened or not, then specific case would come over there. So he will be sued in the court. The another party will be sued in the court. When the contract is of the personal service. So when the contract was for some personal service, means you will drop my car over there. Fine. You will come to my place for dry cleaning my sofa or dry cleaning my house. So that is my personal services which are being provided by, which are being accepted by me only. Then when one of the party is incompetent to the contract. So when one party is incompetent, he or she is not able to complete that contract because of one or the another reason. So that is incompetent to the contract. When the contract is ultra vires, so when the contract is not able to be performed because of some XYZ main reasons which are over there and the contract is not being performed. Then where the contract is made by the trustees in the breach of trust. So when the contract is made by the trustees of some trust, or when there is a breach of the trust. So the trust was being breached over there. When a subject material part of the subject matter of the contract has been ceased to exist. When some conditions or when some part of the contract, they are being seized. They are being stopped over there. So these things won't happen, means these conditions won't happen, but rest of the contract will happen. So that is not a contract. Then when the contract is inequitable to the either party. So when the contract is being felt that it is not feasible, it cannot happen, it is inequitable to both the parties, means both the parties are not coming into the win-win situation. So then also the contract will be a suit for the specific performance. Next are the quantum merits. The right does not arises out of any contract, but it is of the quasi contract nature. So the right does not arises from the contract, but it will be the own natural things which are coming out of both the parties. This right arises out of some past performance. Some work is done, some service has been rendered. Suppose there was one person who has already performed some work at my place. So today I'm going to make payment to him against the work which he has done earlier last week. So he has done that work last week, but today I'm giving something to him. So that is the right which has arised out of there. So he has done his work last week, so he can demand the money for the same, or he can demand something out of that. It is by the nature restitutory. So the natural process which is happening over there, it arises when the quasi contract is in existence. So when some quasi contract is in existence, then also it will happen into the quantum form. Now, what are the damages? This right arises out of the contract. The damage. The damage would come. It is the right of the either party to demand for the damage, to pay it for the damage. The right arises when there is non-performance. So when the performance has not happened, so another party can demand for the damage to be paid. It is by the natural compensatories. So naturally something has happened. It arises when a contract is broken. So when the contract is broken, then also the damage has to be paid. In the natural compensatory means when one party is not able to perform, he is quiet for his part, then he will pay for the damage of the contract. So same in contradictory with this discharge of the performance, we have the legality of the objects and the consideration. So in legality of the objects and into the consideration, it would consider that what is to be given in the form of the consideration. So in the introduction part, we will discuss if an agreement is to be enforced in a court of law, but the consideration and the objects of the agreement must be lawful. So whatever is to be given into the consideration, that must be legal, that must be lawful. When one of the consideration or the object is unlawful, the contract is void. So when one of the condition is unlawful, then it will be considered as a void contract. Means one of the things it is not possible to happen, it is unlawful, then it won't be a contract. In order to constitute a valid contract, both the consideration as well as the object must be lawful. Otherwise, would be void. So both the things, the one performance, the A what is being performing, so A what he is giving, that must be particular object, and what is being given back to the same A in the consideration form, that should also be lawful part. Fine. So both the things, both the parties, they must give a lawful object and the consideration against that object. According to section 23 of the Contract Act, the consideration of the object of an agreement is lawful unless it is forbidden by law. So till law says that it is not possible, it won't happen, so that is forbidden by law, or is of such a nature that if permitted, it would defeat the provision of any law. So if it is not happen, if it is not being happened, or it is, if it is not being performed, that it, then there would be a provision of any law to defeat it. Or is fraudulent, it's fraud, or involved or implies injury to a person or the property of the other. So if it is not able to happen, it is causing injury to the property, it is causing injury to the person, personal injury, person damage is there, then also it won't be considered over there. Or the contract regards it an immoral. So it is immoral. It is legally not morally good. Or opposed to the public policies. So, or it is against the public policies. It's against the public. It's against the society. Then also it won't be considered. In each of these cases, the consideration or the object of an agreement is unlawful, is void. So in all these cases, the cases which we have discussed, the fraud, the injury to the property or a person, giving threatening to someone, immoral acts, infraudulent one, causing the or opposing the public policies or opposing the society. So these all things are considered to be unlawful, or they are being considered as void. Now, what is consideration? When we are going to give something in return. So someone has performed some duties and I'm going to pay him in return of that duty. So that is, paying that person is known as the consideration. Section 2D of the Indian Contract Act defines consideration as when, at the desire of the promisor, the promisee or the other person has done or abstained from doing or does or abstained from doing or promises to do or to abstain from doing something, such act or the absentism or the promisee is described as the consideration for the promise. So when something is being done and something is given in return for that thing, for that work, it would be considered to be as a consideration. A agrees to sell his home to B for rupees 10 lakh. Here B is promised to pay rupees 10 lakh in the consideration of A's promise to sell the home, and A sell that home is the consideration for B's promise to pay 10 lakh for the same. So A is the house, that is the object, and the consideration is 10 lakh, which will be paid for the same. So that is the consideration part. When the consideration or the object is lawful, unlawful, it is forbidden by law. Law forbids an act of for various reasons. If the consideration or the object of an agreement is doing of such an act which is forbidden by law, the agreement is void. So which is the condition, the contract or the promise which is unlawful, which is fraud, or the fraudulent part is there, which is forbidden by the law, they will be considered as the void contracts. Example, A promises B to drop a prostitution which he has instituted against the B's robbery, and B promises to restore the value of the things taken. The agreement is void as it is an object of the unlawful. Now robbery is there. So robbery means that is unlawful, that is forbidden by the law. So it is not at all considered good. It's morally wrong. It is not good in the eyes of the law. So that would be a void contract. It is not a valid contract. And it cannot be taken to court also. If it is of such a nature that, if permitted, it would defeat the provision of the law. If referred to the case where there being no express statutory prohibition against a particular type of the contract, the nature of the contract is such that would be against the spirit of the particular law, where whether entered or whether enacted or otherwise. So when some kind of nature is there, when some kind of particular nature is there, when it is being permitted, it would cause the thing to happen, or it would be considered as an invalid over there. Means something which is invalid, which cannot happen, and it is invalid in the eyes of the law, then it would be considered as a one which is not being permitted. So naturally it won't happen. For example, we will consider an example. An agreement between the husband and wife to live separately is invalid as being opposed to Hindu law. So Hindu law doesn't say that the husband and wife should live separately. No. An agreement by the debtor not to raise the plea of the limitation is void. So when some debtor is there, which the person has to make the payments, so that would be considered as the plea of the limitation. It won't be considered over there. No, this is not possible in the terms of law. If it is fraudulent, so fraud is there. It refers to the contract which are entered between the parties with an object which is fraudulent or with a purpose which will be infected, promote the fraud. So if it happens, it is going to promote the fraud. So then again, it won't be considered as a valid one. A promises to pay rupees 200 to B. If B commit fraud on C, B agrees. B is agreeing to defraud is unlawful consideration for A's promise to pay. Hence, the agreement is illegal and void. Now, making some fraud to someone is totally illegal. It's totally illegal. and A is paying the amount to B so that he may make a fraud to C. So this is illegal. So automatically A's contract with B is also illegal. It is void one. A, B and C enter into an agreement for the division among them the grain acquired or to be acquired by them by fraud. So they are going to acquire the grains in some fraud conditions, in some conditions which are fraud one. So gaining those grains in the fraud condition in itself is a void one. It's unlawful object. So it is very illegal. It's very unlawful. So again, it would be a fraudulent part. If it involves or implies the injury to the person or the property of others. So if the object of an agreement is to cause the injury to the person or the property of other, it is unlawful. So it will be cause, it will be unlawful if someone causes an injury to the person itself or the property of that person. So that will be illegal. Injury means the criminal or the wrongful harms. An agreement to commit an assault is void. So whenever someone causes any injury to some person or some property, then it will be considered as a fraud and it is a void one. An agreement by which a debitor who borrows rupees 100 promises to do manual labor without pay of the credit. So long as the debit was not being repaid in full has been held to be the void as it involved the injury to the person of the debitor. So the person is doing the work, but it is not being paid. So again, it will be a case of the fraud because it will be the case of, sorry, it won't be a fraud. It will be the case of the injury caused to that person because he has already involved his labor into that, physical labor into that. A, agreement between some person to purchase the shares in the company and thus by fraud and deceit to induce other person to believe that there is a bona fide market for the share if won. So again, we are saying to someone that it's bona fide, but in actual, it is a fraud one. So again, it would be void condition. Next would be, if the court is going to say, if the court regards it to be immoral, so agreement which has contrary to the goods moral are illegal and void. If the consideration for the agreement is an act of the sexual immorality, the agreement is illegal. Now, A agrees to let her daughter to B for concubinage, the state of living together as a man and wife without being married. The agreement is unlawful and immoral. The agreement for the future marriage, so that would be again unlawful after they are being divorced also or they are being living together. Unlawful and illegal agreement. Unlawful and illegal means the pretty much the same thing. They are both the same things only. Unlawful and illegal. The unlawful agreement is one which, like a void agreement, is not enforced by the law. It is void and is destitute to the legal effects altogether. It affects only the immediate parties and has no further consequences. It has happened to the immediate parties only. And it has not any, it does not put any effect in the future consequences. An illegal agreement is not only the void as between the immediate parties, but has this further effect that the collateral transaction to it also become tainted with the illegalities. So with the contract which is happening between the immediate parties, if they are not coming into the effect, then the collateral transactions has also happened over there and it will be tenanted with the illegalities. For example, L lent rupees 5,000 to B. So L has given 5,000 rupees to B, help him to purchase some prohibited goods from T, and aligned enemy. If B entered into an agreement with T, then the agreement will be illegal and the agreement between the B and L shall also become illegal. being collateral to the maintainer to the main transaction, which is illegal, L cannot therefore recover the amount. He can recover the amount if he did not know that the purpose of the loan. Now, A, L has given a loan to B for B, that is rupees 5,000 as a loan to B for purchasing some prohibited goods, the goods which were prohibited, which are illegal. Goods from T, which is an aligned enemy, which is our out of country enemy is there, fine. So B is going to purchase those goods from T, which is an enemy. Now they have entered into a contract that is illegal. And L was knowing that B will be going to purchase these things. So knowingly he has gone into the contract. So automatically L would also be affected into the same contract. So L would also be punished and L would also be considered into the main parties which are coming into the illegalities. If, in second condition, if L was not knowing the purpose of the loan, if L was not knowing that why this loan has been paid to B, then it may be considered over there. Then the amount may be recovered from B. Effects of illegalities, where the illegality is servable. So where the things can happen, it is servable. Reciprocal promises, so one is giving the promise, another is giving. So that is reciprocal. Alternative promise, one branch being illegal. So one branch is being illegal. Then the agreement voids. If the consideration and the object unlawful is a part. So when the consideration is not there or unlawful object is there, the objects are unlawful, that won't be considered into the illegalities. That will be not happening over there. So that's all for today for the topic. Thank you everyone for patient listening.